Thank you. That concludes the debate on Trusts and Succession Scotland Bill. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion 11616 in the name of Martin Whitfield on behalf of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee on Standing Order Rule Changes, proxy voting. And I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press their request to speak buttons. And I call on Martin Whitfield to speak to and move the motion on behalf of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee.
I'm very grateful, Presiding Officer, and it has been an afternoon of the small minutiae of law and standing orders and of how places operate. But this is no less important than the stage three that we have just gone through, because the motion before the Parliament invites us to agree a permanent proxy voting system be introduced. The pilot is currently running and is due to end on the 31st of December this year. And as members will be aware, it provides for a member to arrange their vote to be cast by another member acting as proxy in any vote of the meeting of the Parliament or indeed the committee of the whole Parliament. We recognise that there may be certain circumstances in which, even as an MSP, you may need to step away from the obligations and responsibilities of being an MSP places on you. This might be for a period of time due to illness, parental or caring responsibilities, or sadly in some cases, bereavement. The Standards, Procedure and Public Appointments Committee has conducted an evaluation of the pilot, including an internal consultation with all relevant stakeholders. The responses have indicated that there is support for the provisions that are currently on a temporary system to be made permanent. The committee has reflected in its report on future parliamentary procedures and practices that we consider proxy voting accords with the very founding principles of this Parliament, that to ensure it can be more inclusive and accessible. And indeed, the recent gender-sensitive audit recommended that we as a committee propose a permanent standing order to introduce a proxy voting system. We wish the permanent system to be broadly mirroring the current temporary arrangements, namely, the standing order sets out in principle that a member may arrange for their vote to be cast as a proxy, but the details of how such a vote may be exercised sit in a separate scheme that's administered by you, the presiding officer. And can I also take this...
John Mason.
I thank the member very much for giving way. He's listed reasons why people might not be here. Does he think there's also a risk of the system being abused, as with the present online system, where it appears that some members just don't bother turning up?
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful for the intervention, but I don't feel that I can be in agreement even with the sub-statement about an abuse of the online system. Members of the Scottish Parliament, when they are sent to this place, are sent to this place by constituents who entrust in them a promise to represent their constituents to the very best of their abilities. And I would struggle, indeed, I find it very difficult to understand a situation where a member who sits within this chamber, or indeed rightly understanding orders is contributing in a hybrid way, that they would abuse that position. To be an MSP carries with it a responsibility, and I think it would be very disappointing if an individual chose to abuse that responsibility for whatever reason. I'm happy to give way to Bob Doris.
I thank the convener of the committee for giving way. Of course, I think Mr. Mason is making a distinction between proxy voting and remote voting, which of course are two very distinct and different things. I support the proposals from the committee, and I praise the committee for its good work in relation to this. But can I just check that reforms the committee will suggest to this Parliament remain iterative and evolving, and you will come back at a later date with further reforms, and the entire chamber will be kept updated and involved in that process?
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful for Bob Doris's intervention, and indeed all of the changes that are proposed sit on this iterative basis, because we will never achieve the perfect chamber. It is always going to be a journey. It will be a voyage. And it is for all members across this chamber to contribute to that, to add their ideas, opinions. And I know the committee and indeed others across this chamber are always more than happy to debate proposals. I merely took the stance I did with the previous intervention because I think it lays an accusation on which there is no real evidence to base it. I was going to take that moment to indeed thank you, Presiding Officer, I hope not in any embarrassing way, for your substantial support, contribution and assistance with regard to this matter, which has been both gratefully received both by myself and, of course, the committee. The practical operation of this proxy voting proposal will remain as set out in the Presiding Officer's scheme. And as detailed in our report, we gave consideration to some of the practical aspects of the scheme. And the scheme, I understand, has been finalised and, if endorsed by the Chamber today, will be able to be published on the 22nd of December. The only real change between the temporary system that's been in operation and the permanent system that is being proposed is that within standing orders we will set out the grounds that a proxy vote can be requested on. And more than welcome.
Kate Forbes.
Thanks to the member for taking a third intervention. I was curious as to whether there was evidence as to how we protect members sometimes from being under pressure to adopt a proxy vote when they might be incapacitated and may not be able to actually engage with the substance at hand, but might be under pressure to vote nevertheless.
Martin Whitfield.
The member raises a fascinating and an interesting problem that has, to some extent, been handled in both the evidence that we've had, but also discussions within the committee. There are a number of ways that votes can be reflected, even if not cast across this chamber. And the committee in various iterations have visited whether or not we wanted to address the concept that is known as pairing, for example. But what we wanted to do with proxy voting and what was reflected, sorry, what the committee wished to do with proxy voting and what was reflected both in the very first debates that the committee brought to this chamber and indeed the discussions that we've had, is to protect the members who under certain circumstances need to step away from the obligations of being an MSP but still be in a position to reassure their constituents that the constituents' vote through their elected representative appears in this chamber for the purposes of legislation. If there was a situation where a member was being pressured by someone else to extend a proxy vote, I deeply hope, as my response to one of the earlier interventions was, I deeply hope they can find it in themselves to reach out and say no, because we are sent here. The majority of the constituency MSPs are sent here because of who they are themselves. The list MSPs are obviously sent under a party political list. But we are individuals, and we have an individual responsibility to our constituents, and we should add to that. I realise time is late, so I simply want to move the motion that is in my name, but on behalf of the committee, and I hope following the vote, on behalf of this whole chamber. I'm grateful, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on standing order rule changes, proxy voting. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of business motion 11737 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on a change to the business programme. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press their request to speak button now, and I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm moved.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak against the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 11737 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 11723 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
And moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak on the motion. And the question is that motion 11723 be agreed. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 11724 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on a Stage 1 extension. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press their request to speak button. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
And moved, Presiding.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak against the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 11724 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is consideration of two Parliamentary Bureau motions. And I ask George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, to move motions 11725 on approval of an SSI and 11726 on committee meeting times.
And both moved.
Thank you. The question on these motions will be put at decision time. And I am minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 11.2.4 of Standing Orders that decision time be brought forward to now, and I invite the Minister for Parliamentary Business to move the motion.
More than happy to do so. Moved.
Thank you. And the question is that decision time be brought forward to now. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. So the first question of today's three questions is that motion 11699 in the name of Siobhan Brown on Trusts and Succession Scotland Bill be agreed, and there will be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.